You know, it's been 6 years since Jack Kemp passed away, and two or three decades since he served in the House and in the first Bush administration, ran for president, and then with Bob Dole ran for vice president. And it's been even a bit longer than that since he captained the San Diego Chargers and the Buffalo Bills as a great quarterback. But he continues to loom large over the American political scene. His arguments for supply-side economics and his energetic, upbeat image still influencing a number of Republican politicians. Among them, notably, a Wisconsin congressman named Paul Ryan, who you might have heard about lately in the news. A biography of Jack Kemp is especially timely, and Morton Kondracke is especially well-positioned to have written it, along with Fred Barnes of the Weekly Standard. Mort has been a prominent journalist in this town for over 40 years. Succeeding in both print and broadcasting. It was the Chicago Sun-Times that brought him to Washington in the 1970s to cover the White House. And before that decade was out, he had moved to the New Republic as executive editor. He then joined Newsweek to be the Washington bureau chief, and in 1991 took over as executive editor of Roll Call, a post he held for 20 years. Parallel to his career in print, he became a widely recognized TV commentator, first as a panelist on the McLaughlin Group, then co-hosting with Fred Barnes their own show, The Beltway Boys, on Fox News, and also contributing regularly to the evening, to Fox's evening news program, Special Report. So Mort clearly knows how to report and how to tell a story. And 5 years ago, when he was invited to take on the job of lead interviewer for an oral history project sponsored by the Jack Kemp Foundation, it was only a matter of time before he could shape all the accounts about Jack Kemp that were being collected into a comprehensive biography. Mort spoke here at PNP 14 years ago when his first book, Saving Millie, was published. And that book, of course, became a bestseller. So we're delighted to have him back this evening to talk about Jack Kemp, the bleeding heart conservative who changed America. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Morton Kondracke.
Well, I'm delighted to be at my neighborhood bookstore. We used to live at the Kennedy Warren down the street and bought a lot of books here over time. Any of you who ever watched the McLaughlin Group or Fox News will understand that I'm also glad to be anywhere where I can finish a sentence without getting interrupted. My co-author, Fred Barnes, thought about joining me here tonight for about 5 seconds, and then he chickened out. Because he figured that he would encounter an army of liberals, and that he might not make it out alive. He's.
Can I just take a poll? I mean, how many are liberals?
You're
the other persuasion. All right.
We have a balance. Well, he's a lot more conservative than I am, just for your information. So. He calls me a mushy moderate, and I confess that I am. Bradley did give you the history of how I came to write this because of the oral history project, and in the back of the room, another neighbor of yours, stand up, please, Jimmy Kemp. This is the person who got me into all this. This is Jack's. This is Jack's son, who really lives literally around the corner. He was president of the Jack Kemp Foundation and got me to do the oral history, and then created the Jack Kemp Chair in Political Economy at the Library of Congress, where I lived for 3 years and went through Kemp's papers. So why did we write the book? So the first reason is encompassed in the first sentence of the book, which we thought would be intensely controversial, but has been gotten a lot less static than I expected it to. So the first sentence of the book is that Jack Kemp was the most important politician of the 20th century who was not president, certainly the most important Republican. And I will, and no biography had ever been written about him, and I knew a lot about him, so it was, you know, it was a natural to do it. The second reason is that he led an interesting life, with which Bradley has summarized. You know, he was a football player, then he became a politician. He was a self-taught intellectual. He was a natural-born leader. He was a bleeding heart conservative who tried to mount, when he was HUD secretary, a conservative war on poverty, which he could not do because George Bush the First was not really interested in urban policy until the riots of 1992, when he suddenly decided to adopt all of Kemp's program, but it didn't go anywhere. So the third reason is the one that I'm going to spend the least amount of time, and that is that Fred and I just got to basically relive our personal journalistic lives through the experience of Jack Kemp. And as a matter of fact, I have to say this: when in researching this book and going through all the articles that were written about it, some of the best of them were written by Fred Barnes for the Weekly Standard, for the Baltimore Sun, for USA Today, for, you know, lots of places. He really was insightful about what Kemp was up to. But the fourth and most important reason is that we think America is in deep trouble, and it's polarized. The wages of the average worker are stagnant to declining, and we hope to inspire or possibly embarrass present-day politicians into adopting Kemp's model of positive, optimistic, idealistic, growth-oriented, compassionate politics. I got to say that they're not adopting it very fast, but hope springs eternal. I mean, you know, if we can get it into the bloodstream, then it might work. So let me go back to the first reason. Why was Kemp important? As Bradley said, he was the original and the leading advocate of supply side economics, the idea that lowering individual tax rates across the board would incentivize work, savings, investment, production, and make the economy grow, give people jobs, and produce prosperity for the country. Now, he modeled his tax cut formula, Kemp-Roth, on a bill originally proposed by John F. Kennedy in 1962 and passed after Kennedy's death, lowering the top tax rate from 90% to 70%, with comparable cuts for people at lower income levels. And he often quoted Kennedy's speech to the Economic Club of New York in 1962, quote, "It is a paradoxical truth that tax rates are too high and tax revenues are too low, and the soundest way to raise revenue in the long run is to cut taxes now." Democrats tend to forget that this idea is initially a Democratic idea. And Kemp was also a devoted believer in Kennedy's maxim that a rising tide lifts all boats. And until he was convinced by Vernon Jordan, who was at that time the president of the Urban League, that some boats are stuck on the bottom and that you need government's help to lift them. So Kemp eventually convinced his party and then Ronald Reagan to adopt Kemp-Roth. The original Kemp-Roth bill was for a 30% across the board tax cut over 3 years. Reagan adopted it in 1980 as the basis of his presidential campaign, and in somewhat watered down and delayed form, it actually got passed in 1981. Now it is liberal dogma that Reaganomics didn't work, but in fact it did. And I invite you all who remember just to think back to the 1970s, and those of you, and I see many of you, or who are too young to remember the 1970s, it was a miserable decade. Inflation rose to 13%, prices that were rising at the rate of 13.5% a year in 1980. The unemployment rate reached 7.1%. The post-war U.S. economic growth rate from 1950 to 1973 was 3.6% a year. For the next 10 years, it averaged 1.6%. The stock market in the 70s lost 70% of its value. And because of inflation, workers would, and their unions would, demand higher and higher wages, which helped fuel inflation, but they never caught up with it because they were pushed into higher and higher tax brackets because they were making more money, and so they were taxed at a higher rate, and they net lost after tax income. Economists of the era had no idea what to do about this. I mean, the simultaneous high inflation and high unemployment just was inexplicable to Keynesian economists. I mean, they usually, if unemployment was high, then inflation was low and vice versa. But to have them simultaneously going on just wasn't in the book. And the presidents of the era didn't know what to do about it. Richard Nixon imposed wage and price controls. That didn't work. Gerald Ford handed out win buttons, whip inflation now, told everybody to lick their plates clean. Jimmy Carter put on a cardigan sweater and told everybody to turn down their thermostats. That didn't work. And the country was in a deep funk in the 1970s. It was the era of the misery index. The inflation rate plus the unemployment rate in 1980 was 23. Inflation plus unemployment, 23%. In 1979, only 13% of the American people thought that the country was headed in the right direction. At the same time, the U.S. was suffering geopolitical reverses. We had hostages in Iran. The Soviets were in Afghanistan. And Jimmy Carter delivered his malaise speech, which basically said it was the acquisitiveness of the American people that were causing all of our problems, and that there were limits to growth, and we just had to face it. And his White House counsel, Lloyd Cutler, wrote an article in Foreign Affairs magazine saying the constitutional system that we have now simply does not work, and we need to have a parliamentary system so that the president and the Congress are elected simultaneously, and what the president says, the Congress will do. So that was the mentality. It was basically, it doesn't work anymore. We can't. Nobody can govern, and prosperity is over. So in 1980, Reagan adopts Kemp-Roth. He passed it, as I said, in somewhat diluted form in 1981, dropping the then top tax rate from 70% to 50%. In Reagan's second term, Kemp was one of the pioneers, along with Bill Bradley, Democrat of New Jersey, of tax reform, became the tax reform bill of 1986, which closed a lot of tax loopholes and dropped the top rate to 28%. Dropped millions of low-income people off the tax rolls, the income tax rolls entirely, and lowered tax rates for everybody in between. Now, it's true. There was a terrible recession in 1981 and 1983 at the beginning of the Reagan administration. Unemployment reached a high of 10.8%, the highest, even higher than it got during the Great Recession, the highest it's ever been since the Great Depression. And of course, Democrats blamed it on the tax cuts. But in fact, the tax cuts had not gone into effect at the time of the recession. The recession was really the result of Federal Reserve Chairman Paul Volcker's policies to crush inflation by raising interest rates. And the prime rate reached a high of 21.5%. I remember we bought a beach house at Bethany Beach, Delaware, and the initial mortgage rate on that purchase was 20% a year. And of course, we kept refinancing and refinancing as inflation came down and the interest rates came down. But that's how bad things were. And it was all designed to squeeze inflation out of the economy, and it really did. But it caused a recession that would curl your hair, as somebody said. But after that, after 1983, we had an economic boom that lasted really all the way through the Clinton administration up until 2000. Bill Clinton raised the top tax rate, I think, from 33 to 36%, but he didn't raise it to 50% or 70%, and nobody has proposed, maybe Bernie Sanders is proposing it now, to raise it back up to that level. I mean, basically, it is baked. The results of supply side economics are sort of baked into the economy, although, of course, special interest groups have drilled holes in the tax code to provide themselves with special benefits that I will get into later that will need to be closed again. So the growth rate from 1983 through the Reagan years averaged 5, 6, 7, almost 8% a year. It was 7.6% the growth rate in 1987, and it was 7.9% in 1988. Unemployment dropped. The misery index went from 23% in 1980 to 7.7% in 1986. And in 1986, 69% of the American people thought that America was headed in the right direction. 13% under Jimmy Carter, 69% under at the end of Ronald Reagan. And geopolitically, American economic success plus Reagan's defense buildup stressed the Soviet Union to the point of collapse. It didn't collapse under Reagan, but it collapsed shortly thereafter. So you could say that Jack Kemp, indirectly at least, had a hand in ending the Cold War. And for a time, at least, all around the world, democratic capitalism was deemed to be the end of history, you know, the natural point that every society would deem the correct, the correct way to run your country. It's in somewhat some doubt now. So it did work. It worked in a lot of ways. Reagan was the president who put it into effect, but Kemp was his catalyst. So that's reason number one. Reason number two, that he led a fascinating life. He was raised as a Christian Scientist, and I learned a little bit about Christian Science, and just a little. And part of it is that reality is all spiritual, and the outcome of the corollary of that view is that anything you think you can do, you can do. It creates this kind of infectious, perhaps irrational optimism about things, and Kemp was imbued with it. So he applied it to his football career. He decided at the age of five that he wanted to be Bob Waterfield, the famous quarterback from the Los Angeles Rams, and he played high school football pretty well, but he was deemed too small to get into UCLA or USC to be a quarterback there, so he went to Occidental College. He didn't start at Occidental College until his junior year. He was a little college All-American, third team, right? Not even first team. But somehow he got himself into the NFL draft, and he was drafted number 523, right, out of the whole draft. And then he was cut by five NFL or Canadian Football League teams over the course of 3 years. But he did not give up. And one of the family's sayings was, if one door closes, another door will open. And sure enough, the American Football League was created, and Jack Kemp first signed on with the then Los Angeles Chargers, soon the San Diego Chargers, and then he, in a preseason game, was throwing a pass and knocked his finger against the helmet of an onrushing lineman. He didn't leave the game. His finger was dislocated. Ring finger was on his passing hand was dislocated, and he kept putting it back into shape, into place, and the result of it was that it had to be fused. The doctor said, so how would you like it fused? And so he got a football, put his hand around the football, and forever afterwards, this finger was, you'd shake hands with him, and this finger was sticking in your face, like that. So that's the kind of guy he was. And the other football players were reading Sports Illustrated and Playboy. He was reading the Wall Street Journal, and then he started reading the conservative economic classics, Milton Friedman and Friedrich Hayek and Ludwig von Mises, and he really read them, and he absorbed them. And he became Newt Gingrich said was an autodidact. He self-taught, a reader of history, expert in international economics, monetary policy, defense policy, foreign policy, and all that. He had been a mediocre student in college, but he became an expert. And during his quarterback days, his eyes were open to discrimination, to racial discrimination. The team would go to a southern city, Houston, where the owner of the team, the San Diego Chargers, owned the Hilton Hotel. The white players stayed at the Hilton Hotel. The black players were all required to stay at a black college dormitory somewhere. Kemp put an end to that. Kemp put an end to the policy that black players room with other black players and white players room with other white players, and he and Bill Bradley had this thing in common where they both lived. Bill Bradley said, I lived in largely a black world, and Kemp lived in a partially black world sport, and what Bradley said, I learned that whether somebody could shoot a basket or was selfish with the ball or passed it off or played like a team player had zero to do with race and everything to do with character. And that's what Kemp, at one stage, Kemp was on a radio program when Barack Obama was running for president, and whoever the host was, I think it was Sean Hannity, started railing about Obama's black preacher man in Chicago, and just ranting and ranting and ranting. And Kemp said, "Stop it, quit. I'm not going to listen to that. Shut up. It's got nothing to do with race." And Bill Bradley said he had tears in his eyes listening to Kemp saying that. So that's, you know, that's the sort of guy Kemp was. Our third reason is, as I said, personal. You don't need to hear about it. I covered Kemp. Fred covered Kemp. We lived through the period. You know, I have confessed in public that Ronald Reagan is the only president that I ever was in the tank for as a journalist, because I saw the country turn around. You know, and I said anybody who can do this has got to be a pretty good president. But the most important reason that we wrote the book is that America's in deep trouble. I mean, the average wage of the average worker has not grown in 25 years. It didn't grow. It grew during the Reagan years, but it hasn't grown since. And that's largely, I mean, Bill Clinton didn't raise the average wage of the average worker. George Bush certainly didn't, it's owing to partly to globalization, partly to technology, and nobody has figured out what to do about it. Workers are faced with rising health care costs, they're faced with rising tuitions, and so their standard of living is declining. And what's more, a majority of Americans think that their kids will not live as good a life as they live. That's the dimming of the American dream. And our politics are so polarized and so hateful that we can't get anything done. We can't build infrastructure. We can't. The Republicans are dedicated to austerity. The Democrats are dedicated to spending money and creating government bureaucracies. They never talk to each other, and we're getting nowhere as a country. So what Kemp always said was that in a period of stagnant growth, what happens is that politics becomes the art of pitting one group against another and convincing your constituents that the other guys are getting fat and rich at your expense. So it's rich versus poor, it's black versus white, it's Sunbelt versus Rust Belt in those days, and now it's rich versus poor, and some candidates are blaming Mexicans, right, or immigrants, immigrants of all kinds, and Democrats are blaming Republicans, and Republicans are blaming Democrats. So, I think that Kemp's spirit is relevant to today, and some of his policies are relevant. The equivalent of the tax cuts now would be another tax reform. We need to lower the corporate tax rate. We need to lower individual tax rates, but we also need to eliminate loopholes. I mean, what's happened is that every lobbyist group in town has managed to drill a favorite little hole in the tax code to benefit them. Those special interest loopholes have got to be closed, and it's got to be fair. Enterprise zones, which was Kemp's idea to basically eliminate capital gains taxes in poverty areas to attract businesses to those areas and create jobs, basically never got tried. Bill Clinton had a version of it, but it never involved capital gains rates. It was basically a subsidy program, and Kemp was a convert to the idea of education vouchers, to give parents the opportunity to choose the school that their kids would go to, so that they weren't condemned to go to lousy schools, which most urban schools in this country are, if you've ever seen Waiting for Superman, the movie, you'll see just what a crushing situation it is when you can't get into an alternative school and your kid is going to have to go to a gang-ridden place where the unionized teachers basically don't give a darn or think that poverty cannot be overcome, whereas charter schools have proved, KIPP academies and green dot schools in California have proved that you can take poverty kids and make college graduates out of them in the end. So Kemp's spirit is what's really needed. It's especially needed in his own party. Kemp wanted to make the Republican Party once again the party of Abraham Lincoln, in both senses, in the sense that of Lincoln the emancipator, pro-civil rights, pro-immigrant, welcoming, inclusive, and Lincoln the Whig. I mean, Lincoln the Whig was in favor of public investment in infrastructure, basically, to make the economy more efficient and therefore prosperous and therefore give everybody the right to rise. Kemp was incapable of negative campaigning. It cost him. Even in the 1996 vice presidential debate with Al Gore, even though Bill Clinton already had ethical issues, namely the Democratic National Committee was collecting money, some of it raised by Al Gore, from China, from Indonesia, from Buddhist monks, and so on. And this was a big story in the newspapers. And so the first question in the vice presidential debate is, in effect, Secretary Kemp, what about Clinton's ethical problems? And what Kemp said was, Bob Dole and I have decided that we will not go negative. We regard our adversaries as our opponents and not our enemies, so we will not go low road. And of course, that it took the wind right out of the issue, and it demoralized the entire Dole campaign. As a matter of fact, Bob Dole didn't talk to Jack Kemp for a long time for the rest of the campaign. He was incapable of being an attack dog. Fast forward to today, and the campaign is all about insults and finding scapegoats and all of that. So we need Kemp. We need the Kemp spirit. We need the Kemp spirit, and we need a lot of Kemp policies. And with that, I will stop, and I will answer any question you might have. Thank you very much. Nobody wants to challenge the idea that Reaganomics worked? Yeah, go ahead. You're supposed to go to the microphone. Sorry.
Or I can just speak.
You're there first?
You go first.
First, I want to thank you for teaching me something today. I had no idea that Lloyd Cutler and I had anything in common, and I'm gratified to hear that he too felt that we have to go to a parliamentary system. My question is this. Most of us on the right, it's almost intuitive, it is intuitive to us, that if you want more of something, you tax it less. If you want less of something, you tax it more. Another way of saying supply-side economics, you pointed out how it worked in the 1980s. Of course, it worked very well in the 1920s under Coolidge, so there's lots of examples of it. But the prevailing opinion in Washington among my friends on the left and in Washington, Montgomery County, and so forth, is that, no, that doesn't work. In fact, all you're doing when you do that is you're taxing the rich less, and somehow that hurts, taxing rich less, and somehow that hurts poor people. So my question is, why is it, do you think, that so many people in this town have a hard time intellectually grasping what to you and I seems so obvious?
Yeah, and you know, and they're repudiating John F. Kennedy as well. I mean, you know what? I honestly think that there is a place for some Keynesian activity like building infrastructure. I don't think that is entirely wrong, but fundamentally, you're right. If you tax something, you'll get less of it, and therefore you get less investment and less growth. Why? It's dogma, you know. you just read, all you have to do is read Paul Krugman every single day. He's saying the same thing over and over and over again. Larry Summers says the same thing. But supply side economics has lost its purchase on intellectual purchase, and in fact, I mean, the Republican answer has been for years, and was under George W. Bush, the answer to everything is to cut taxes. Well, every tax cut is not necessarily a good thing. I mean, you know, what George Bush did, some good tax cuts and some bad tax cuts, and it really didn't work. So, you know, it's been discredited. And then the Republican Party, I didn't even get into this, the Republican Party has become the party of austerity, back to what Kemp was fighting with Bob Dole about, and Gerald Ford and David Stockman during the Reagan administration, that what you have to do is squeeze the spending side of the ledger to as close to nothing as you can possible, you know, lower the tax rates and drown the government in a bathtub, the Grover Norquist school. And it's not about growth. The Republican Party has basically not emphasized the growth message, and I think it's left the field to the Democrats intellectually. Yes, sir.
Hi. I have a question regarding the last thing you said about Kemp's vision and how it continues to today. Are there any politicians that you would point to that embody Jack Kemp's vision for America? I would posit Congressman Paul Ryan and his Path to Prosperity budget embodies some of the Kemp principles, and he is a figurehead that Congressman Ryan that looks up to Jack Kemp, Republican or Democrat. Are there any politicians that look up to him?
Paul Ryan was an intern under Jack Kemp at Empower America, which was his little think tank. And actually, it was Paul Ryan who wrote the paper that Kemp used as the basis for an article that he and Bill Bennett wrote together denouncing Proposition 187, which was Pete Wilson's effort to deny illegal immigrants health benefits and schooling and stuff like that. Paul Ryan, Paul Ryan became chairman of the Budget Committee, right? And he became kind of an austerity-minded guy, and Kemp did not like it. But now that he's the chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, and hopefully not Speaker of the House, because the right-wing fanatics will kill him, just the way they did Boehner, he believes in growth. Furthermore, sort of out of the public eye, Paul Ryan is going around with Kemp's inner-city mentor, a guy named Bob Woodson, and visiting inner cities practically every week and listening to poor people talk about their lives, and he's trying to figure out what can you do to fight poverty. I think John Kasich has a lot of Kempian characteristics, pro-immigration, pro-growth. I think Jeb Bush has a lot of Kempian characteristics. Marco Rubio, to some extent. So I mean, there's hope, but unfortunately, we have Donald Trump at the top, and the Republican rank and file, I must say, partly whipped by talk radio and Fox News, are think that an outsider has got to run things. Somebody with no experience is the best idea for president of the United States. They're so furious, and that's the problem. That's the problem. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for your talk. I've watched you for years, and I used to work for Jack Kemp, but he asked my question, and you took it. So I was going to ask you what you thought of Governor Kasich, because in my book, he is the closest to Jack Kemp. Thank you.
Yep. So I don't know. The one problem with the Kempians is that they don't have his vim and vigor. And his, I mean, he was, Newt Gingrich in one of the oral histories said that the closest historical precedent for Jack Kemp was Teddy Roosevelt. And you know what Teddy Roosevelt did, grabbed people by the lapels and the shoulders and shook them until they listened to him. And that's the kind of guy Jack Kemp was. And Kasich and first, certainly Bush and Paul Ryan too. I mean, they're not exactly charismatic, house of fires the way Kemp was. Yes, ma'am. Oh.
Yeah. I watched you earlier this week on the on C-SPAN where you and Fred Burns were in the morning, and one of the callers called and asked you about the supply side economics of George W. Bush, the tax cut and the deregulation, and how it worked out during the Bush administration.
Did I punt?
And I was surprised that you said it actually worked for the first six years, and
I
the last two, except for the last 2 years, you said it worked good.
I think
good.
Fred said that, actually. I honestly cannot explain to you why growth was not stimulated by Bush's tax cuts. What Bush started in a sort of a he lowered rates, and Kemp was not exactly happy because he didn't lower capital gains rates. Then he lowered capital gains rates, and there wasn't a boom. Now, and I gotta say that the experience of George W. Bush raises questions about the eternal validity of the supply side formula. But I mean, it stands to reason that if you cut the rates and you eliminated loopholes and you made the economy more efficient, that you would encourage productivity. So I guess I'm punting on the question again, but I honestly can't say why it didn't work under Bush.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, thank you very much for your work, your book, and for your talk tonight. I just want to ask you to explain your beliefs behind your statement that Republicans are the party of austerity and Democrats are the party of government growth and big spending, when the facts clearly show, you can look at any study, that the deficits and the debt has gone up appreciably more under Republican administrations than Democratic administrations, and Clinton lowered our deficit more than any president in decades. So I'm, knowing those facts, I'm interested in how you reach your conclusions.
Okay, so Clinton's balancing the budget was the result of two things. It was prosperity, growth, increased tax revenues, decreased unemployment, and therefore the outlays. But he was muscled into balancing the budget. I mean, what he was not a budget balancer. He was forced to balance the budget by John Kasich, actually, and Newt Gingrich, the Republican Congress that came what was it? Let's see, 1992, he gets elected. 1994 forced him to balance the budget. And then the budget got, it was a paper balance. So I don't think that, and anyway, Bill Clinton was a different kind of Democrat in most ways. Bill Clinton was not your average liberal. He was not Nancy Pelosi. He was not Bernie Sanders. Their idea in every city, this is going on in every city in the country practically, the idea is to create a bureaucracy, create a program, raise taxes, try to equalize, you know, incomes by taxing the rich more, and it doesn't work. All you have to do is think about government, as whether government actually delivers what government is supposed to do. And
Of our spending, as you know, is fixed spending for Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security.
And they're
Little discretionary spending,
Those programs are going broke. Those programs are going broke, and we have to have a system under which we moderate. We don't not necessarily cut for existing workers, but moderate the growth of those programs, and at the same time eliminate farm subsidies and ethanol requirements. I mean, I think Kemp once wrote a letter along with Trent Lott to David Stockman, who wanted to raise taxes on beer and cigarettes. And Lott and Kemp said, "How come you're going to tax poor people, and you're going to leave Exxon and Gulf Oil and Boeing and their subsidies and their tax breaks alone? So you got to do all of that, I think. Schools are a particular example. The government runs schools in city after city after city in America stink, and they are condemning kids to poverty because they're not equipping them to live in a high-tech age. They've got to have competition.
Well, I know there are other people for questions, so I'm going to sit down after this. The school debate is an entirely different story.
It's based on tax revenue.
And you know the condition of cities and the tax base in cities for decades has not been where it needs to be to sustain equal education opportunities.
D.C. spends more money per pupil than any school district in the country. And it's all spent on bureaucrats. Some of the bureaucrats exist because federal requirement. Now, I'm not saying we should get rid of the Department of Education. I'm not saying that. But the amount of paperwork that government generates for people who are actually trying to do something is just enormous. Yeah. And
if you look at the stats, government enrollment government employment has reduced dramatically. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Kondracke, thank you for writing the book. Jack Kemp has been a personal hero of mine for since I became a Republican back in high school. I didn't know it was did not realize that it was not very popular for a black person to be Republican. And so I was looking for people who I could look up to in the party, and Jack Kemp was one of those persons. And so my question to you is, can you talk some more about some of his personal experiences that shaped his, what I would say, a conservative heart? Arthur Brooks talks about having a conservative heart and says, yeah, you know, I'm a conservative because I care about the poor. And I think that's a wonderful statement. I think it's a true statement. And so is there something that you can talk about that dives back into his personal story that really was not just talking about the economy or the economic effects that could help uplift people or have a right to rise, but there has to be some type of a personal connection, a genuine concern and compassion for people of color in the community? And did he face any type of challenges within I'm a Republican, in the party, in his leadership rank, in trying to push and move our party in that direction, which I think we're still trying to push that way as well?
Yeah. Well, actually, his grandmother, known as Grandma Sunshine, grew up in the Dakota Territories before statehood. And she always talked in their house about how it was their duty to help poor Indians. And this was in the climate of the home that he grew up in. And his father was a Republican. He was an entrepreneur who almost went bust in the Depression, but created a trucking company and hired on an equal opportunity basis and treated the workers like family and all of that. And Kemp, when he worked there on summers and stuff like that, would have to have lunch with not with his dad and his dad's brother who ran the company, but with the workers. But I think football had a lot to do with it. I mean, he as I said, you know, he's got to have a line that protects him, right? And whether the guards and tackles are black or white does not make any difference to him. You know, all he wants to do is survive, right? And then he encounters discrimination, and he's deeply offended by it. And as I mentioned, what kinds of action he took. In 1965, the All-Star game of the AFL was supposed to be played in New Orleans, and the black players were not allowed to go to lots of restaurants. They had to go in blacks only taxi cabs, and they decided to boycott New Orleans, and they wouldn't play. And Kemp was the president of the American Football League Players Association. He was a pro-union Republican, by the way, and he joined the boycott. And it was moved to Houston, which by that time had been integrated. So, it just went on and on and on, and one thing led to another. I mean, he had black friends. He had, it's interesting, when the Rodney King riots happened in 1992, he was going to go out there, and Maxine Waters, the radical left Democrat from Watts, called him up, and people who were Kemp held the phone away because she was screaming at him that he was a racist, that he was, and it was profane, and that he the F word, F bombing him, and stuff like that, and said, "You come to Watts, and you will be picketed." So Kemp calls his friend Jim Brown and his other friend, John Mackey, who had been the president of the NFL Players Association, and Jim Brown worked with gangs, and he actually got the Crips and the Bloods to put down their arms and serve as Jack Kemp's escort party, and the picketers, Maxine's picketers, never showed up. So, I mean, there's just story after story after story about he just had it in his heart, It's in the book. It's in the book. So, yeah, I know nothing. No, I wrote a book. I wrote the first draft that, if it came out in the book, would be 560 pages long. So, a lot of what I know is not in the book, but all those stories are.
Got time for one more question? I'm always surprised at the dearth of good Republican journalists. It's nice to wake up in the morning.
I am a moderate independent. I honestly am. Regard myself as a Republican.
Right. No, I mean, I look at, I'm happy to wake up in the morning with Morning Joe.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure to see he's the top show in the morning. And I like his stance against guns. And very few Republicans will stand up against guns nowadays. And he really comes out on it.
Yeah.
Where would Jack Kemp be on this?
Oh, I think he had a perfect NRA record up until 19. No.
Assault weapons?
He had a perfect NRA record while he was in Congress, and then in 1994, and this is where somebody asked, did his positions hurt him? He was thinking about running for president in 1996, and he came out for an assault rifle ban, and that contributed to and it came out against Proposition 187 and so on and so forth, and, we cared about the poor and, all of that, and he didn't run mostly because he didn't want to spend all his time raising the money that it took, but also partly because the party had moved to the right, way to the right of him. Thank you.